I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I could count them, they are more than the sand. I awake and I am still with you. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there's any grievous way in me. And lead me in the way of everlasting. God, you saved us. God, you searched us. And God, you purify us. God, you love us so much that you make us more and more like your Son. One who loves, one who lives for you, to know what it means to be known by you. God, you have made us fearfully and wonderfully. And so God, that is why we are here. We are here to declare who you are in our lives. And God, that you are present, that God, you are real, that God, you are alive, God, you are working. And God, we are your people. So strengthen us. Speak to us. Father, I give myself to you, asking you, God, that you would do that miraculous work that you do so often. When the word is preached faithfully, lives are changed. And God, I ask that you would simply do that through me, not by my own efforts, but truly by your grace and by your Spirit. We ask that you would speak. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You remember in college, for those of you who have been able to go to college, there's a season in which, especially when you form a group of friends, there's that season where everyone starts to talk about who they may start to date, or who they at least potentially like and are thinking about maybe marriage-type material. Right, there's that sense of maybe it's a sophomore year, you've kind of formed that group, there's about maybe 15 people in there, and two people are always hanging out, and you're just wondering, is there something going on? Well, I remember during this time, I met a girl, and she came to me with this like, dream that she had. And she had these bright eyes, she couldn't take the smile off of her face. So I'm interested, what's this great dream that you had that you can't take the joy out of your face, right? And then she talks about how she had a dream about her wedding day. I was like, okay, tell me more. Tell me more about your wedding day. I want to know who this lucky guy is. And so she talks about the venue and how it's so beautiful. She talks about the lights and the flowers and the way that everything was decorated. She talks about how beautiful everything was, that it was so perfect, and how she longs for that day. Well, as she's talking, I just have one question in mind. I'm like, who's the guy? Like, hey, who's the guy that, you know, that really makes your heart skip that beat? And then I ask her, and then she closes her eyes and she tries to think about the wedding day, and already I could tell, like, oh, this is kind of weird, right? She's thinking, and she's thinking, and she's thinking, and then she opens her eyes, and she sheepishly says, I don't think there was a guy. Like, I don't think there was a guy in my perfect wedding. I'm like, that's actually probably true for many marriages, right? That's what a perfect marriage looks like, no spouse. But it's this idea, right? For her, she had this beautiful wedding day pictured in her mind, and then when she starts to think about it, she realizes there was no groom. And so she's shy, she's embarrassed, right? Because she's missed the main thing. Actually, in the Christian life, in the church, there's actually something that's going on that's called the Godless Christianity Movement. In 2009, Newsweek put out this article, The End of Christianity, and it talks about this Godless Christianity Movement where all these people are now fleeing the church because they're saying God is not actually making a difference in my life. And so the author starts to investigate, why is it that all these people are leaving the church? And basically he starts to figure out that from this philosopher from the 19th century named Nietzsche, he declared that God is dead. And this thought started to pervade all of society where people who were theologically believers, they ended up becoming practical atheists. They say, I love God and I believe in who Jesus is, but from Monday through Saturday, there's no evidence that they're truly born again. They truly encounter God. And with this movement started happening around that time, where it's this idea that God has died. And because God has died, there was no more power within the churches. And though people never acknowledged or even saw that through the language and the ways in which people behaved within the church, God really started to become a part of the Christian church, where they said, yes, I believe, but it wasn't a part of their lives. Here at OEM, I believe God is working. Amen. God is here. Amen. And He is our God. Amen. Now, what would it look like for all of us, right? Every single person scattered around in here, for whatever reason God brought us here to Korea, what would it look like if we, from Monday through Saturday, we lived a life where we actually engaged His presence, not just singing songs on Sunday, but living out our faith, engaging His presence Monday through Saturday, that wherever that we would go, whether we're meeting with someone in a cafe, going to work in a subway, or actually sitting in our desk at work or in college, that place would become holy ground because we're engaged with Him. What would that look like? And that's what I want to talk about today. That's what we will see God talking about in this passage. Let's open up our Bibles to Exodus 33. Exodus 33. How do we engage God's presence? He is alive. He is here. He's not just here. He goes with you wherever you go. What does it look like for us to actually engage His presence? That wherever we are, it becomes holy ground. The first thing that we see is that we have to engage in His guiding presence. Can we repeat that? Engage His guiding presence. Before I read 33 verse 12, we have to understand the context of this passage. And if you know a little bit about the story of Exodus, the Israelites were enslaved. They were in Egypt for quite some time, and He sends Moses to deliver them through these different miracles over and over and over. And God takes them across the Red Sea, and you see God working, providing for them manna, providing for them quail, so that they would survive in the desert. Well, in this time, there's a time where Moses actually goes up to the mountain for quite some time, chatting it up with God, talking to the Lord. And it's in this time that the Israelites starts to question, hey, where's Moses? He hasn't been around for some time. And that's when the people start to gather together and they think about how can we figure out something. We feel that God has left us. And so if you know the story, they take all the gold from themselves and they make this golden calf, and then they declare, hey, this is the God. We need a God. This is the God that saved us. And you start to think, what happened? And that's what we want to talk about. After this passage, basically God says, after that incident and basically a patterns of unbelief, He says, you people, Israelites. Yes, He says this. You go to the promised land. He says, but I'm not going to go with you. You go to the promised land, but I'm not going to go with you. Because you're a stiff-necked people. You're a sinful people. If I went with you, I would consume you. I want to go with you, but you're stiff-necked. You're sinful. And so we pick it up in verse 12. Moses said to the Lord, see, you say to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You have said, I know you by name, and you have also found favor in my sight. Now, therefore, if I have found favor in your sight, please show me your ways, that I may know you in order to find favor in your sight. Consider, too, that this nation is your people. And he said, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. What Moses is saying is, God, don't send us up out of here if you're not going to go with us. It's better that we don't go if you don't go with us. So God, please, if you send us, please go with us. And that's why he says, if you go with us, you will show me your ways in verse 13. It's God's presence that guides His people. They would not make it to the promised land if God did not go. He guides them. He leads them in that way. And in verse 14, when it says, "My presence will go with you, I will give you rest," it's not the sense that as God's presence is here, we rest in Him. That's theologically true. But here, what God is saying is that you will find rest in the promised land. "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest in the promised land." Moses knows full well they will not make it to the promised land if God doesn't actually go with him, guiding him. We want to engage in his presence in such a way that every single day, whatever we are doing, we're engaged with him. He guides us. As he leads us, we follow. Because this world is a difficult world, right? And it's very hard to make the proper decisions. I can't remember how many times people ask me, "Oh, because you're a pastor, can you counsel me? Can you help me understand which way I'm supposed to go?" Right? Not just for big decisions, but even smaller decisions. What does it mean to parent well? Which job do I take? And it's a sense that we struggle to hear from Him. We struggle as He leads for us to follow. But there's a very big difference between the Israelites and us. You see, back in the day, they didn't have the gift of the Holy Spirit. If you know the story of the Bible, what happens is as Christ dies the death that we should have died, and He atones for our sins, as He goes up to heaven, as He ascends, what does He say? "Wait here, I'll send you" who? The Holy Spirit. So the people are waiting, and that's what you see Pentecost happen. People receiving the Holy Spirit. And you see in the letters of Paul that when you believe, you receive the Holy Spirit. The main difference for us and for the Israelites is they needed Moses to access God. For all of us, we have access to God. Not just Him in the throne room, but He's here present. But not just here present, here within our hearts. The living God resides in you. Amen? He resides in you, but some of us at the same time don't hear from Him. Right? And the New Testament often talks about Christians who aren't walking by the Spirit. The way that they're described is they're sleeping. And often the call is, "Wake up! Wake up, church!" It's like the sense that the Holy Spirit is pounding on your heart, and all you're doing is, you're just sleeping through it all. And what God wants to do is not just as He leads, but as He leads that we will truly follow. Do you remember back in the day when there were no GPS systems? For I think most of us, we remember the day. If you don't remember the day, well, youth is on your side. But it's been more than 10 years since the first GPS came out. The first GPS that came out within a car was a 1995 Oldsmobile. If you're from America and you know what Oldsmobiles are, you have also dated yourself. But when you purchased a GPS, a global positioning system, it would cost, back in the day, $2,000. And we've come a long ways, right? We all have a GPS on our phones. Well, I remember before the GPS came out, I had to take this long drive. I cannot believe what my parents were thinking when I think about it now. But as a 16-year-old boy who just received his license, my parents asked me from Chicago to go to Pennsylvania, which is about, I forget, I don't know how, 15-hour drive, to pick up my brother who was in college and come back. Can you believe that? I mean, I can't believe what my parents were thinking. No cell phones. Hey, no cell phones. So what do? You know, I'm not that tall. I open up this gigantic map. I'm like, okay, here's Chicago. I have to take, I think, I-88. And I have to go, that's what I was doing, And in these cars, there would be these gigantic maps and these gigantic atlases. That's the Old Testament. The Old Testament is like they had the law. They had the ideas in which what God wanted you to do, but there was no GPS. And for us, we have the GPS. Not the global positioning system, but the God positioning system, right? God is within our hearts, and He leads us and guides us, convicts us, searches our hearts. So we've got the Holy Spirit within us. So it's not like you look at a map and try to figure out, oh, which way do I go? But because the GPS, because God is in us, we can decipher. But even with that, the analogy falls short. And this is why it falls short. Because for a lot of us, we have the Holy Spirit. We're Bible-believing, God-fearing, Christ-exalting believers. But for some of us, if we turn on the GPS, what we see is that little dot that says that this is where you are, beep, beep, right? But there's no map. Right? There's no map. God is working, but there's no grid, there's no map. And what does it say in Scripture? That as we, let's actually look it up. In Romans 12, you see it in your bulletins. In Romans 12, it says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual act of worship. So we give ourselves to Him in service, in our lives, with all of our heart, soul, mind, strength. We give ourselves, we offer ourselves up to Him. And then in verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your minds, that by testing you may discern what the will of God, you get that? What the will of God is. What is good, acceptable, and perfect. It's this idea that as you give yourself to God over and over and over, your mind is renewed. But it's not just through the Spirit, it's through the Word of God, right? So as we hear the Word of God, as we study the Word of God, as we start to have a grid, a map, a worldview of how to see life, the values in which God has values, what starts to happen is within our little GPS system, the maps start to come out. The ways in which we should go come out, right? As our minds are renewed, we start to have a grid in which He desires for us to live. In Korea, it's very hard to follow your GPS. When I came to Korea initially, I had a very hard time. I would always take the wrong turn. You know what I'm talking about? And so if you recently moved to Korea, in the U.S., the GPSs are like this big. Here in Korea, they're like this big, right? And in this, there's all these roads. And as a GPS was leading me, I didn't know how to follow. And I feel like that's a lot of us, right? And because of that, we take wrong turns. And because we take wrong turns in life, we waste time. And see, what God is desiring for us is as the Spirit of God truly is alive, working within our hearts, searching our hearts, there's no grid for a lot of us because we have no biblical knowledge. We have no knowledge of Scripture. And so God is trying to lead you, but often we don't follow. How do we become more sensitive to the Spirit? It's really simple. It's not easy, but it's simple. Every day, we simply open up the Word, not just to do it for the sake of doing it, but we continue to encounter Him. He continues to teach us values, ways in which we live. Not just that, not just study of the Word, but in prayer, we let God speak to us. And in that, we start to understand the ways in which He leads us. We become more sensitive to His Spirit. There's a man in history who was known to continually engage with God. His name is Brother Lawrence. And many of you know who he is. He's written a book that's very popular called Practicing the Presence of God. And in this is what he says. There is not in the world a kind of life more sweet and delightful than that of a continual conversation with God. And then he says this. Those who comprehend this are those who practice and experience it. Those who truly practice and experience it are those who can truly say there really is no life better, no life more sweet, no life more delightful than one whom continues to engage His presence, have continual conversations with Him. And so he says this in the book, that even when he's doing the dishes, even when he does the dishes, this is what he would pray. Lord of pots and pans and things, make me a saint by getting meals and washing up the plates. Wouldn't you love to have been married to him, right? Lord of pots and pans and things, make me a saint by getting meals and washing up the plates. It's not just about engaging God when there's a powerful worship service or a strong community. Obviously, those things are important. But it's about seeking him in the mundane. It's about seeking him when you do the dishes. It's about when you get your child ready for school, you're conversing with the Lord. And in that, he gives you patience. In that, he guides you in what to say. As you go to work on the subway, as you sit at work in your desk, or as you study, you engage with him. And when you do that, you know what happens? It becomes holy ground. Becomes holy ground in such a way that when you're sitting at a cafe, having a conversation, and you're engaging with him, that place becomes holy ground. And I want you to imagine all of us scattered throughout Seoul, Monday morning, we're purposeful. His presence is there. He's working within your hearts. And in the past, as he's trying to speak to you, you haven't listened. You're too busy. You're too distracted. But imagine Monday, all of OEM, purposefully engaging his presence, engaging, being led by him as he guides us, as we parent, as we get ready for school, as we sit in a meeting. Those places become holy ground. Starbucks becomes holy ground, right? Because you are engaging with the Lord. OEM, let's make Seoul holy ground this week. Amen? Wherever we are, his presence is there. His presence is not just around, but it's in within our hearts, communing with him. Engage in his guiding presence. But also, engage his glorious presence. Can we repeat that? Engage his glorious presence. So I want to continue reading and go back to the story of Exodus in verse 15. And this is now Moses responding. And he said to him, if your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up out of here, from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, and I your people, if it is not your going with us, so that we are distinct, I and your people, and every other people on the face of the earth. What Moses is saying is, God, you are everything. It's because of who you are. You make us distinct. You give us value. You tell us. You remind us who we are. He's saying, God, if you don't go with us, don't even send us. God, you're everything. If you want us to stay, if your presence is here, God, we will stay. Why does he say such prayers? Let's continue on in verse 17. And the Lord said to Moses, the very thing you have spoken I will do, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name. The Lord says, I will do this. I will go with you. For the reason is, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name. That's the second time he said this. This is the second time God has said this. And actually in verse 12, he says a very similar thing. I have spoken to you. You have found favor in my sight. I know you by name. What God is saying is, I get it. I understand how much you need me. And so I will go with you. I know your needs. I know who you are. I know your struggles. I will go with you. And then, in verse 18, Moses says this. Please show me your glory. So God says, I will go with you. I know you by name. And then now Moses, all of a sudden, says, God, please show me your glory. What's going on? What's this exchange that's going on? Well, glory, what it literally means is kavod in Hebrew. It means heaviness in weight. It's this heaviness of weight, of his goodness, of all of who he is, his holiness, his greatness. It's the outward manifestation of what's real inside, for who God is. It's what Moses is ultimately saying. As God is saying to Moses, I know you. I know your needs. Well, Moses is now replying back to him by saying, show me your glory. He's saying, but I don't really, really know you. God, I want to know your glory. I want to see your glory. I want to experience your glory. I want to know all of who you are. And in that, what do you see? You see him coming before him. In verse 19, he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord, God's name. God says, I know you by name. What Moses is saying is, God, I want to know you by name. God, I want to know who you are. Show me your glory. It's so hard for us to comprehend what glory really means, isn't it? I mean, the best way that I could describe it to you is there was a moment where my brother was moving out to California, and I was living in St. Louis, and St. Louis is very far from LA, and so he was going to drive out with all his luggage. And so I decided to take this road trip with him. Well, basically from St. Louis to where Utah is, it's really just all corn. Like really, there's like nothing there. It's like the most boring drive you'll ever go on. And so someone told us, but when you get to Utah, make sure you go on the Southern Highway because you're going to see some amazing canyons. It's like, all right, I'm sure it's going to be pretty cool. So when we get to Utah, we'll make sure we go on the South Highway and we'll experience some pretty cool canyons. Well, basically, the whole ride, like my brother and I, we're just falling asleep. Right? There's like, we're trying to have conversation, but basically we're just bored. There's nothing to look at. But basically, when we get to Utah, we take the Southern Highway, and we take this turn. And the next thing you see, what you see is this vast array of golden canyons and gorges. And so my brother and I, we're not very much into nature, but we have to stop. So we stop and we get to the edge of the canyon, as far as you can. And we'll just take a gander at what's down there and realize how deep it is. And then I look up, and for a moment I'm dizzy. Because I don't think my eyes have ever tried to take in the vast creation that God has made. And so just for a moment, I lose my balance, but I gain it back. And I just see all around me a golden canyon with these deep gorges. And we just sit there, my brother and I, for about 5-7 minutes, just appreciating God's glory. And what comes into my mind is that if God can make that, how much more glorious is he? How much more powerful is he? In that moment, I realized how tiny I was as I experienced how grand everything else is. And when you take a moment, you should start to picture how small are we to an infinite and holy God. And so what happens in this passage, when Moses asks, show me your glory, this is what happens in verse 19 to 23. He said, I will make all my goodness, I will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you what? My name, the Lord, Yahweh. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But he said, you cannot see my face. For man shall not see me and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft on the rock. And I will cover you with my hand until I pass by. Then I will take my hand away and shall see my back. But my face shall not be seen. Do you see what's happening? God is saying, you want to see my glory. I will reveal myself to you. But know that what you're asking for, I cannot really do because I'm too holy. I'm too glorious. And so what God desires is that he manifests himself in his glory. But in doing that, he covers Moses' face and say, if you were truly to see my glory, you would die. You would be consumed. And what do you see there? You see the holiness of God, but yet the grace of God. He meets Moses where he is at. And he says, you want to experience my glory? I will reveal myself to you, but in holiness and in grace. And so we see this actually happen in verse 5 of chapter 34. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, the Lord. Again, the name of God, it's relational. The Lord, Yahweh, Yahweh. A God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and kindness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. But who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers and the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation? And so what does Moses do in response? The only thing one could do when you experience the glory of God. And Moses quickly, at once, bowed his head toward the earth and worshipped. What happens when you encounter the living and glorious presence of the Lord? It becomes holy ground. It becomes holy ground, and you worship. Some of you may be saying, how do you know? How do you really know that the glory of the Lord is the greatest thing? How do you really know that the glory of the Lord is what we all long for? For you may be able to say, I've tasted some of the best glories, some of the best things of the earth. You may be able to say, I have tasted the finest of foods, the best of wines, nirvana-esque pleasures in life. You may be able to say, how do you know the glory of the Lord is the greatest thing? It's what we long for. You haven't tasted the things that I've tasted. And I would say, yeah, I haven't. I haven't tasted the finest of foods, the best of wines, nirvana-like pleasures. But this is what I can say I have tasted. I've tasted the living God. I've tasted Him in the core of my heart. And I would say, you've tasted only but streams, tainted with sin, tainted with mud. And what you drink of, it may taste good for a moment. And you may say, I've tasted glory. But what I can say is I've tasted from the reservoir of the glory of God. I've tasted from the ocean of who He is. And I've tasted Him. And I can say He is good. Amen? Can't you say that though you've tasted some of the things of this world, what it does within your heart is this. It makes your heart big. You experience nirvana-esque pleasures. But what always happens with sin, it leaves you with death. You experience highs in such a way where your heart expands, but you're left with nothing. And you sense a deep void, a deep longing. But when you experience God, what starts to happen is true life enters into your heart. And you can start to see again, taste again. It's like you have new life. And that's what Scripture talks about. I have come here to give you true, eternal life. When you don't have that, when you don't have that presence, when you don't experience the glory of God in that way, you know what starts to happen? You start to give yourself to all the pleasures of the world. That's exactly what happens in the beginning of chapter 32. Right? Moses is gone for a little bit. And in verse 1 of 32 it says, when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered themselves together to Aaron, said, and this is what they say, make us gods who shall go before us. And then listen to the language. As for this Moses, before Moses was their leader, but now they changed the language. There's sin growing within. As for this Moses, the man who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. And so in verse 4, we see that he received the gold from their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool and made a golden calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Egypt." What happens? God delivers them from Egypt. He delivers them through the waters. He provides them with manna, with quail. You see God working. And for the first moment when it seems like Moses is gone, because this whole time all they knew about God was really through Moses. Moses was their access to God. And so now Moses is gone. They start to panic because they've experienced some glory, but now they think God is gone. And so immediately what the people do is they do something as foolish as create a golden calf. What you will experience in life is that if you don't experience the glorious presence of God, you will continue to throw your heart, throw your life into places where you think glory exists. Whether it be sex, drugs, or rock and roll, or whatever it is, you continue to throw yourself to that thinking, this is where I will find glory. This is where I will find life. And C.S. Lewis talks about this in a very well-known passage that many of you already have heard. And he says this, "It seems that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling around with drink, sex, and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. We continue to give ourselves to the glories of this world, and in that our hearts grow big, and what we're left with is nothing, a void, a longing." God would say, it's not because your desires are too great. It's not because these glories are too great. It's actually because your desires are too weak. It's too small. You're too easily satisfied. You settle for a glory that is tainted of sin. It's only but the streams of mud that stems from what God originally intended. But for us, for you and I, what we have by the gospel, what we have by the cross is access to the reservoir of the glory of God. Engage in His glorious presence every day and make that place holy ground. Lastly, we see not just engage His glorious presence, but engage His purifying presence. Can we repeat that? Engage His purifying presence. In verse 5 of chapter 33, He says this, the Lord says this to Moses, "Say to the people, you are a stiff-necked people. If for a single moment I should go up among you, I would consume you." Right? This is the beginning of the whole story. And what the people want is, God, you have to go with us. But God replies back by saying, I can't go with you. Because if I was to go with you, I would consume you. I would consume you because I'm so holy. But listen to Chapter 34, verse 9. 34, verse 9. "If now I have found favor in your sight, O Lord, please let the Lord go in the midst of us." And then listen again. "For it is a stiff-necked people." Let's stop there. You would think the way in which this sentence would finish is that, "For we are a stiff-necked people, and God, if you go with us, you will consume us." But we see something change. God is about to do something. He hints. It's pointing forward to the cross. In verse 9, we see that what he says is, "For it is a stiff-necked people, and so because you are a stiff-necked people, what I will do, because I am holy and I am gracious, I will pardon your iniquity. Pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for your inheritance." What God is saying is, I am holy, yes, but I am also gracious. And as Moses wanted to experience His presence, he does with both holiness and grace. And so we see God come down, but yet at the same time, protect him. Because He's holy, but yet gracious. And in this, we see the same thing. He will go with the people of God. But the way in which He will go with the people of God is He says, "I will pardon their iniquity and their sin, and you will become my inheritance." What God does, He provides a way in which because He is holy and yet because He is gracious, He provides a way by atoning for our sins. It's very important to know that no matter how good the Israelites tried to be, they would have never bridged the chasm that is between their sin and God's holiness. It's like saying, if we're trying to get our way up to God by simply our efforts, it's like saying this. It's like if I, a fairly athletic man, I think, but if I was to jump from here to the first row, and I'm thinking in my mind, this is the chasm that I have created because of my sin. And so if I just try really hard though, like really hard, I practice for and train for about a month, and I take that leap, I may make it. Right? Maybe some of you doubt me, okay? It's fine, I'm not offended. But can you imagine that that's the chasm? But in reality, that's not the chasm, right? That's not the chasm that's made because of our sin and His holiness. Is it more like from here to the end of the sanctuary? It's a fairly big sanctuary. Do you think if I trained really hard for 1 month and I took a really, I ran as fast as I could and I took a running leap, you think I would make it to the end? No, I'd probably fall flat on my face and you'd have no more pastor, right? Because I would die from my foolishness. Well, it's not like this to the front row. It's not like from the pulpit to the end of the sanctuary. It's not like here to the end of the street. It's probably more like trying to jump from here over the Pacific to the U.S. And I'm thinking if I just try hard enough, if I just work out, and if people, you guys pray for me, I could take a running leap and I'll make it over. And I'll finally be good with God. That's how foolish our thinking can be when we think, I just need to try harder. But what this portrays to us is that the reason in which we today, we can engage in His presence is actually because Christ died on the cross, died the death that we should have died, lived the life that only He could live, gives that to us on the cross, atones for our sin as He goes to heaven, as He broke open the curtain to the Holy of Holies, He sends what? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit resides in you. You have access to Him, not because of what you can do, but because of what He has done. You can engage His presence. You have all of what you need. There is no reason we, the people, the church of God, can't engage in His presence every Sunday. But also every Monday. All the grace, all the power of the Holy Spirit is with you. OEM, let's make Seoul a place where it's littered with people who make all different places of Seoul holy ground this week. Amen? Let's pray.